join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Guess I should have read the agenda tonight.
Do you need a copy?
Just kidding, no.
Okay.
I've lost it, but I have it. Okay, first order of business is to approve the minutes from last month's meeting. Any questions, comments, additions, changes? Hearing none, I'd entertain a motion to approve the minutes.
So moved.
Second.
Moved from Brian Mason, seconded. All in favor, raise your right hand. Motion carried, 5-0. You also have had a chance to look at the minutes from the Board of Works meetings. Any questions, comments there?
Nope.
Nope, okay. Communications. We do want to welcome our new council member, Karen Miller, who most, if not all, are probably a little bit familiar with. She's certainly not a stranger to the operations of the city of Rochester, and we're very happy to have you on our council. Didn't know when we were back in school we'd be doing this together with somebody, would we?
Well, I knew I had that same conversation.
Also, listed in the communications, the information regarding the dam.
Yes.
Anything that you need to talk about there?
Yes. Last year, Larry Hoover had contacted me. Well, it might have been Dave Thompson. Might have been right at that transition. The state had acquired a grant to go through and study all of the different dams in the state, and ours being one of them. So the engineering firm, LF&A, which is Lawson Fisher Associates out of South Bend, was the contract winner on that. So they were basically tasked with the ideal that they needed to investigate all the dams, look them over, and come up with a strategic emergency plan for the dams in the event of any kind of leak or any kind of breach, that type of thing with our dams. Week before last, I attended a meeting. They basically brought three of us together. They brought us, Goshen, and North Webster together to go over our plan specific and then to make recommended change, read through it. This is just a draft version. Make changes that we needed to make. And through the course of that meeting, I learned that the city actually is responsible for the dam. That's been a question kind of tossed around that we weren't 100% certain if it was us or the DNR. Well, it's us. And also through the course of this, the DNR and engineers have deemed our dam as a high risk dam, meaning that the potential for life loss and damage is extreme if that dam were to breach or fail or breach. Through the course of this, it was basically the DNR pointed at me and said, you get to be the coordinator for the IEAP, which is the emergency preparedness plan for the dam, which I was a little taken back by that because I wasn't sure that it really fell in my wheelhouse, but he said, you're the fiscal officer, that means you get to cut the checks when it breaks. And I went, okay, not gonna argue with you. I have spoke to Lenny. He and I met a little bit because one of the other items that came up out of this meeting was we have to have that dam inspected because it's high risk every 2 years. So we need to actually get an engineer on staff, or not on staff, but on call, on contract, that knows that dam inside and out. We have to have it inspected. They need to come back with a report on that, get them familiar with it, So if there is ever a breach or a failure, which we all, if, well, maybe not all of us, most of us will remember back in the late 80s, early 90s, when the entire city, and then some, I was in high school out there shoveling sand in sandbags to try to keep the dam from breaking. So that's where the memorandum of understanding that was in the packet came to you from, was that agreement with the state and us as far as maintenance, ownership, and all of that good stuff. I just wanted to make sure that you guys were aware of this, because through the course of our budgeting, we're going to have to carve out some money to get an engineer in here and get that dam, because right now it hasn't been inspected, and at least I know of, and Lenny could probably say even longer, we know at least 5 to 10 years that that has not been inspected, other than by the DNR, which is not a full-on inspection from as far as from an engineering perspective. They do know they're coming in this fall, and they're going to be doing some work on it. They had to do some core samples in Mill Creek, and when they pulled the core samples out, there were dead zebra mussels on the bottom of it. The only way you're going to get zebra mussels on the bottom of a core sample that's in the bottom of a creek bed is if there is a breach, or what they call the tunneling underneath the creek itself. So that indicates that we have some problems on the underlying structure of the dam. It is a sand structure. It is not, I thought it was cement. I found out wrong. I was wrong, because the cap of it is all cement. So I thought the whole thing was cement, and it is not. It is a sand, which we all know how sand shifts and moves with water. They did compliment us on the fact that the Parks Department does keep Mill Creek cleared and tries to keep the debris and the trees and everything cleared away from it, which is part of our agreement with them. So they did compliment us on that, and just said that we just need to get a game plan in place and just get it on the roll for every 2 years, get someone down here so that they can become familiar with that dam. So if one of the things Lenny and I chatted about was when Wade's mowing out there, or whoever's mowing, to really watch for any changes. If they see water coming up in places that wasn't there before, and we haven't had a large rain event, if they see bubbling or something coming up out of the creek that just isn't normal, I mean, types of things to look for, because they're there on a weekly basis. And then to notify Lenny, which will notify my office, which at that point then I would call in the engineer and the EMA, and we would go and take a look at it, and the DNR. And we would go take a look at it and see where we're at. It was kind of terrifying to me, and once we get the final report back for the IEAP on this, for the preparedness plan, I'll get distribution copies out to everybody so that you can actually see, got one map here. What kind of terrified me the most was, we have one of our largest manufacturing companies, Rochester Metal Products, would actually be completely underwater. Our water treatment plant would be completely underwater if that dam breaches or fails. And then part of our wastewater plant, according to, and these are just projections, they're not, you know how water is. Water is going to go wherever it can go. So it is something we need to be very concerned about. It's not something that, like, an immediate danger right this minute that it's going to break tomorrow. But we have to be ready for an event if it were to happen. Lenny has been in contact with the engineering firm to get a time scheduled with them to get them down here, give us some numbers on what it would cost to have them come and do a full study, and to keep them on a retainer if we need to have them, because not every engineering firm does dams.
Does the Corps of Engineers have anything to do with this? Because I know when we had the last breach in 89, I know they were in here while that was being done.
Correct, but they are hands-off on this, our particular dam. They are not, it's us and the DNR, according to what the gentleman from the DNR told me. Because that question came up, because I thought the same thing, and he said, no, our particular one, they are not. Now, if something, they could be called in an event, but they're not the first call.
Could they be brought in for inspections?
Possibly, but they recommended, because we're high risk, to use an actual engineering firm and have an engineer on call, because they can't send the Corps of Engineers, those folks, I guess, don't have an established where you can call them when you're in an emergency and say, come in and do this, and that's why they recommended using a firm that's already looked at it.
Does the DNR possibly have a suitable or approved listing of engineers?
They not really. I haven't gone too far with it, because I was starting with the firm that's already looked at it, and they're in South Bend, so their engineers aren't that far away. a lot of the ones the DNR has are in Indianapolis or further, and they said the best bet we would have somebody that's got potentially an engineer that lives close that can be here within, you know, within the hour. So I was starting with them, and then we'll go from there to get, see what other experience we have and what kind of cost we would be looking at.
Since technically we haven't had a timely inspection, did they put a timeline on us for anything?
They just recommended we get it done as quick as we could. Only because they bumped us from a moderate to a high-risk dam, and I asked him, I said, because when he told me that, I said, is it because of, you know, the floodplain or the flooding stream, or is it, what's the reason, or is it because of the structure of the dam? I was more concerned that it was primarily because of the structure of the dam, what they found with this study. And he said this did kind of bump it up a little bit, but it was primarily because of the trajectory of the flow and how many folks in the industry and stuff that would be impacted. And the other side, the other, which doesn't show very much on this map, but the other challenge that we have is that if this were to breach or fail, you would not be able to get to from the east side of the city to the west side of the city without either going all the way around the south side of the lake or going all the way at least 4 or 5 miles north and cut over. And even at that, it could even flood out US 31, depending on how bad it is. So our fire department, our EMS services would not be able to get from one side of the city to the other. So that was the other reason that they were looking at was our emergency service responders. Police department, the sheriff's department would be underwater. Part of City Hall, City Hall would be underwater, our police department, so we would lose dispatch. 911, they have safeguards in place, so they would have alternatives. The only thing, again, this is trajectory or projected, but we would have our garages would not be underwater. So potentially we could move everything out in stage out there if it was not underwater. So that's part of the reason why, because they were looking at the impact of this flow was more where they bumped us up to a higher risk.
Sean, what about the assessment that EMA did 2 years ago when those guys came in and they did the sonogram of the dam that when mm-hmm. they measured the base? Do you have that information from Hoover now? Because it was Dave Poss at the time, but
I don't have that information with me.
That was part of the county's potential damage assessment that mm-hmm. was conducted. Because I got called out there because I got called to go check on two old guys skating on the dam, but they were actually engineers, and they had a machine. They were stopping the water flow, and they were trying to gauge the depth of the concrete and look at the underneath of the dam. Mm-hmm. You might want to get with Larry Hoover now, but at that time with Dave Paulson, but the county did do some type of trajectory.
Well, that was partly with this. Yeah. So that is part of, I don't have that actual documentation, okay. But it was, I know that it was out there because that was part of this too.
I want to follow up with EMA.
Yeah. So there's the bad news for the day.
Oh, that's not bad news. This is, you know, I don't see the sky falling in quite yet.
No.
But
no.
I'd say that since we're shorthanded here, maybe we table this for.
Well, and there's really
there's
not
nothing.
A.
They're going to be searching for an engineering firm mm-hmm. to come as quickly as they can to get here to look
and see if we can get on. Yeah, there's really not any action to be taken. Right. This is just more for your information. So that way, because if, and essentially it'll actually involve more the Board of Works. If there is an emergency that comes up, it'll involve more the Board of Works simply because of the utilities involved, our street department and fire and police. Prior to coming to the council, you guys would be called in if there was a fiscal emergency that we needed to do an emergency transfer of funds or anything like that is where we would
one
call you guys
in. One of the assessments, Shia, was mm-hmm. all the ditches that mm-hmm. we have or where it was going to hold a lot of water, and then the golf course being the old hatchery would absorb a lot. So those guys did a trajectory where it wasn't as doom as you have, but mm-hmm. I'd follow up with what EMA has already done.
Yeah, EMA is involved in this one.
Right.
So that's actually where this started was with their office. And like I said, everything is all projected because we don't, and we can't determine 100% where the, and it would depend on the, if it's a rain event. If it's just a failure of the dam without excessive rain, your water flow is going to be different. If it is with excessive rain, then it's going to be more critical.
Okay.
So, just information, because I wanted to make sure I passed along while it was fresh in my mind before I, something did happen and.
It's good information, we need to know. The other communication is the letter from the Fulton County Solid Waste District. We knew this was coming, but they have officially notified the city that they'll no longer be funding the curbside recycling program, so. Questions, comments on any of the communications? No, then we'll start with our department reports, and I've got Fire Chief Butler first.
Good evening. For the month of June, Rochester Fire Department had 3 auto fire alarms in the city, 2 in Rochester Township. Grass fires, we had 1 in the city, 1 in Rochester Township. Gas leaks, we had 1 in Rochester Township. Accidents, we had 5 in Rochester Township. Medical assists, we have 12 in the city, 9 in Rochester Township, and we drove the ambulance 4 times. Lift assists, 2 in the city. Calls for service, 2 in the city. Police standby, 2 in the city, 1 in Rochester Township. CO check, 1 in Rochester Township, a total of 42 runs and 1 drill. The status of our new employee is he passed his physical and went back down the perf, and the letter should be due in, was sent last Friday. I have not received the shot. Did you receive it today?
No.
So it's on its way. Did you get police to receive it? Well, you got his physical, Bill. But he's projected to start next week. He's going to go on 8 shifts. I'll have 1 shift that has 3 guys on the shift. The other shifts will still have 2. Looking forward to that. Pending your questions, that concludes my report.
Thanks, Chief.
Thanks.
Short and sweet. That was okay, Andy. Yeah. You got quite an act to follow here, Police Chief Shots.
You have my reports, do you have any questions? Is that fascinating?
That's good. Best one you've ever given.
Okay. For the month of June, we worked a total of 25 accidents, one of those being personal injury. We issued 96 total warnings, 56 total offenses, 31 case reports, 700 calls for service, 34 lockouts, 10 towed vehicles, and 8 people incarcerated. Actually, there's 10 people incarcerated. And then you have the crimes that they were lodged for by our officers. Any questions about those numbers? Shada, did you include a copy of the ordinance?
Yes, I did.
Okay. We'll address that towards the end, but I just want to update you guys and let you know what's going on. The high school is changing their flow of travel in the parking lot. When you go west on 15th off of Main, you go make the 90 to the left, make the 90 to the right, that lane is now going to be two-way traffic. There'll be traffic flowing out as well as traffic flowing in. So when they approach Pontiac, we're going to make that a 3-way stop. It's going to be pushing a lot of traffic to 15th and Main. I hope there won't be any. Any problems because of it, but there could be. But there will be. They're trying to get traffic in and out easier and take the pressure off of State Road 14 in Pontiac by the baseball field. However, it's going to put more pressure on 15th in Main, which isn't a great intersection to exit anyway, but we'll see how it goes. But just to make it as safe as possible, I suggested just making that a 3-way stop right there by the practice football field and where it tees into Pontiac. That way there's no question who has to stop and who doesn't. So that's what that ordinance is about.
We discuss that later, you said, or for now?
You can bring up the, I assume.
You can, if you want to go ahead and discuss it now, we can just bump that up.
That's all I had about it, unless you guys have any questions. You can read it towards the end if you want. It doesn't matter to me. Other business, police in the park is this weekend. So just getting ready for that. Saturday evening is when that is, at 7:00. The movie starts at 9:00. So as long as there's good weather, I anticipate a good crowd. At least that's what I'm hoping for anyway. I know Mill Creek Church, they're going to grill hot dogs and hamburgers. They're going to have popcorn, cotton candy, and water. Church of the Heartland, from my understanding, they're going to bring 2 bounce houses and snow cone machine. We're going to have a canine demonstration with our 2 canine officers at 8:00, and then the movie starts at 9:00 on the men's softball field. We did get the electricity upgraded in the press box, so we shouldn't have any issues. Last year we had to use generators, and Chief Butler and I were scrambling to get those going too. So yeah, I'm hoping we have good weather and a great turnout, because I think it'll be a good night. Other than that, that's all I have, unless you guys have any questions.
Chief Schatz, I apologize for coming in the middle of your report. Missing the first half hour, I'm very sorry, but I was watching the Democrat convention, and I'm protesting our Democrat appointment to the council. I was hoping for Bernie Sanders.
I don't think he lives in town.
No, I have no good excuse. I'm sorry for being late. Welcome.
Thank you.
Welcome aboard. Chief, police in the park, it ought to be a good time.
I hope. I think we'll have a good turnout.
We've got a whole ration of things going on the 30th. The Habitat for Humanity folks are having the dedication of their home and are giving out hot dogs to everybody and anybody who comes.
What time is that, do you know?
That's 7:00, or 6:30 it starts.
Tell them not to come to the park.
I know.
We're going to
bump up against a few things, but that's good. There's a lot of things going on.
Yeah.
County exercise.
Yeah, the county exercise.
County exercise.
Democratic JJ dinner.
The Legion are honoring, they're having a memorial ceremony for the unknown soldier on the 30th. This coming up is 30. There's a lot of things going on.
Yep.
With that being said, while you're up here, I had one thing that I really wanted to throw out tonight that really bothered me, and I wanted to do it because we are coming into a lot of homes by television. But you recognize this?
Yeah.
I wanted to get this out to the community. A few days ago, Legion Representative Roy Brown stopped in to see me, and Roy has been instrumental in taking care of the veterans' graves all over the area. He kind of coordinates the Boy Scouts putting flags out the appropriate times and making sure the graves are kept up and such. Well, this is a veteran's grave marker that all of them get, and for years and years and years and years, these were brass markers. There were 2,200 of these in the area, including our 2 local cemeteries and a couple other cemeteries around. They have all been stolen. And I assume they were melted down somewhere along the line for the scrap value. I would encourage anyone out there who's watching this who would know anything about this, please feel free to contact Chief Schatz, City Hall, whatever. Your name will be kept in confidence, but we want these people. The Legion, they're now going around and they're creating a fund. These are $5 a piece. These are plastic replacements. So we've come to that. We have to replace them with plastic. The folks that stole our veterans' markers, that's probably about the lowest crime I could ever think of. So please, if any of you know anything out there, let us know. Thank you. Sorry, Chief.
No, that's fine. I talked to, he is the historian for the VFW. And yeah, he said there were several missing within the county.
Yeah.
But he did say that it happened between 1975 and 2013.
Well, he really doesn't know when exactly they were all taken.
He took over in 2013. And I'm guessing some of them were stolen. However, I did talk to him also, and family members could have taken them home with them, things like that. But yeah, at least we need to know about that.
If anybody knows anything, 2,200 are gone. I don't think many 2,200 family members took their markers home. If anybody knows anything, please let us know. Anybody have any other questions for Chief Schatz? Well, good luck on the park.
Thank you.
Who we got next? Warren.
Warren Lees.
Warren?
I'll start with the wastewater here. Girls in the lab been doing normal lab testing. They tested Lau Industries. They sent in the plant sludge sample for testing for the EPA. We had to reset the chlorine injector. We didn't have a little bit of trouble with that. And also, it's not on my report, but the girls got back their EPA quality assurance testing back, and they passed everything. So that's 2 years straight they've done that. So they've been doing a good job. The guys at the plant mowed the yard down at the plant, cleaned the drying beds, painted the old Forest Farm building. Made a little bit of trouble there. Randy ordered enough paint, and it was all factory mixed. Well, if we looked at it, and I think two of the cans, there must have been something wrong because the shades are not close. So we went back to the people we bought it from and gave them some of the date codes off the paint can. So they're supposed to remedy that. So we got like the north side and part of the east side to repaint, but it looks pretty good what they've done. So we had Bill Walsh come in. The power line to second stage clarifier, it shorted out, it wasn't running, and we've got some issues on that side. We're going to have to retrench that, put in new conduit and all new wires, because Bill said it got tore up when they put some storm drains over there probably 10-15 years ago. And it keeps getting water in and the wires short out. So we're looking into getting somebody in to do that for us. And primary number two, the new drive unit came in. The old one, the bearing went out of it and the gears was chewed up. So that just came in. So hopefully we can get that put back online. In the collections, the guys did locates. We started to replace, I got to replace the Muffin Monster. It's just like a garbage disposal type chewer. That's the name of it, actually. It's been in for 23 years. We couldn't get it out. It's supposed to slide up out of there. So now we've changed our plan. We had Craig's Welding come in, look at it, and they're going to make some rails where it's supposed to slide out of stainless steel. The original ones are aluminum, and the grinder was made out of cast iron, and the two different metals just like welded together. So we're going to go down, pump it down, go down in there, unbolt it, pull the whole unit out, and then put the new stainless and the new unit in. So Craig's is still making them. We had some algae growing down at the plant. We had that in the final. We had to get that out. We mowed the vacuum stations. We cleaned some storm drains at 11th and Madison. Cleaned the storm drain out on Manitow Park Lane. And we cleaned the 11th Street, the wet well out there before we got into the Muffin Monster in there. That's Emma report. You got any questions or?
Is there any discharge coming yet from Dean's? Has that ceased?
No, that stopped. I got I got the permit closure from IDEM about 2 weeks ago. Good. From our inspector, so they're done. So.
Robin O'Neill left me a message. It finally came through later today. The trouble with the phones and everything. From Duke.
Mm-hmm.
Would like to hear from our electrician who is wiring the new building, our pole building.
Oh, okay.
They have to make arrangements to come out and check meter base before they can put the meter in.
Okay. Well, I'll give her a call.
Okay. Anything else for Warren? Okay. Lenny.
He does this all the time. We've just gotten used to it.
It's like trouble with me. He just pushes the ball, and whatever number comes up, that's time for me to go. But
like to keep you on your toes, right?
Karen, like to welcome you aboard. I see you out in your yard all the time working, and looks like we're going to be seeing a lot of each other more. So, well, at the street department, we've been chipping brush and picking up bags, picking up brush. Cleaning catch basins. We went down Fulton Avenue and raised the drains, and EMB came behind us and blacktopped, got them all up to grade the best we could, and we ran the recycling route. We fixed a sinkhole on 531 West 11th Street. We dug that up and decided that it was just some big concrete chunks that had been laying there over the years and settled and created some pockets down in there. So we got that all packed back in, and hopefully that'll be good for a while. And had a couple guys come in and do some weed eating from the tracks on Main all the way down to 9th Street, and on the side streets from 6th Street to 8th. Couple spots on 8th Street we couldn't get to, but they weed-eated and sprayed both. Went over and helped the park department. We do that from time to time, and just for the mere fact we got the equipment and they don't. And we helped them remove the basketball goals at JC Park, and so they could come in and patch the new court. Or resurfaced it, I'm sorry. Took down a fence at Fansler Park. I got in contact with Rick Benush out at RAMC, and had him come over and look at a pole that was about ready to fall over, a telephone pole that was there for a backstop, and at the Ball Diamond, and they came over, him and Joe Koch, and had looked at it, and they determined, well, if the one's bad, all the rest of the other five are probably bad too. Then they said they would just come and replace them all, and the upper supports and everything. So that looks nice. We're just waiting for Eaton Fencing to come in and wrap the poles with the back, you know, the fencing on the back. So
yeah, any update on that? Do you have any idea when
he'll be? I met with him Monday, and he said he would get with the lady that he gets the fencing and stuff off of and get me a quote and give me some kind of roundabout idea of when he could be there, because he said he was pretty swamped. So I told him that it was, you know, we'd like to get it done as soon as possible. So he was going to see what he could do for us on that aspect. So, and so I like to say, I give my kudos to not only Rick Benesh and Joe Koch, but RAMC, or a cell phone company, and a lot of the other people, businesses that kind of help out the city and go the extra mile for the kids, something for the kids to do and stuff like that.
We've got a great community.
Yeah.
And the RAMC has been very,
right,
very good about providing things like,
yeah,
that. Those five holes aren't cheap.
Yeah, you know, if we get a softball game out at the park or something and the lights out, I can give either one of them a call and they'll come and help us out. So that means a lot, you know. But that's all I have.
Lenny, are folks keeping their yard waste up off of the street?
For the most part, yeah. They've been putting it along the curbside better, but they still have them ones
still
put it out in the road. But in that aspect, we just try to get it picked up as soon as possible so they don't.
Yeah.
Head down to the drain area, but
I just wonder if
or it caused a nuisance with the traffic and stuff. So
I just wondered if maybe that was another communication to the public somehow to
keep the yard waste out of the street.
Yeah, because there's been a few instances with the brush, you know, that they, you know, narrow street, they stick it out in the road, a big
right.
pile, and there you are down to one lane roads. kids playing beside it and stuff. It ain't usually in a good situation, so.
Yeah.
But that's all I have. And if you guys have any other questions?
Well, I tell you this every once in a while, but I want to say this in front of the council. Street department's doing a great job. I get compliments all the time.
Thank you.
At how timely you are getting things taken care of, and now changing out signs that need to be replaced.
Yeah, we got a bunch of them.
I know, and I know how we go about it, and it's very academically done, and it's a good process. Doing a good job.
All right, thank you. I appreciate that.
Any other questions? Okay, thanks, Lenny.
Thanks, Lenny.
Hey, we'll save the best for last. Mr. Derrick, I thought you were on vacation. Well, I appreciate your coming in to do your report, Derrick.
I'm coming far away.
Well, thank you very much.
The month of June, the water department did the following. We read meters, orders, repaired or replaced bad meters, locates, lab work, backwashed filter beds, shutoffs, swept and mopped the plant, reorganized and swept and mopped the lower and upper garages. Not really mopped, but blew them out. Ran the weed eater, painted the trim at the walk-in doors on the upper garage and the lower shed, painted the trim on the doors on well 3, 4, and 5, located and raised main valves on West 13th Street so that EMB could mill and blacktop the road. Fixed two main valve boxes in front of the post office that were broken. One of them was pretty bad, so I thought the sooner we could get to that, the better off before we have to pay getting somebody's car fixed. Located and painted main valves on Fulton Avenue, Monticello Road, and Clayton Street so that EMB could mill up the road and blacktop it back. And we stayed in contact with EMB that whole time. If they ran into any issues, we supplied them with more risers so that they didn't blacktop over our main valves. Painting to the hydrants, you guys are aware that we hired two part-time young men to paint hydrants. Week one, they painted 52 hydrants from the new Subway restaurant on State Road 14 all the way around the Elks area. Week two, they painted 33 hydrants from the Subway restaurant back around to Ewing Road. And that number was smaller due to the weather that week. And then week three, they painted 61 hydrants from Goose Pond Road back into Manitow Heights. Week four, they painted the same amount, 61 hydrants from Manitow Heights area down State Road 25 in the 4th Street area. That totaling 207 hydrants were painted in the month of June. Other digs that were performed, we fixed a leak at 1126 Washington Street in the alley, made a new tap at 1113 Arthur Street, made a new tap at 1198 Ridge Road, disconnected the old service line at Hickory Creek Nursing Home. We made a new 1.5-inch tap for them. They were having some issues. Determined that they're pretty sure they had a leak underneath the building somewhere. So the easiest route for them and for us as well is they had two taps made that went into one line, and that's what fed them. So I thought the best for our interest and their interest was to eliminate the two taps and just make 1.5-inch tap and then be straight shot in for them. As of right now, they're not having any issues. Call-outs, Randy Wynn was called out on the 15th due to the plant alarm. The reason he came in was because the phone lines were not working properly and it was not letting him log in on his tablet or the phone to check the plant out. Myself was called in on the 22nd to 1116 Madison Street due to a leaking meter. I replaced the bottom of the meter and everything is okay now. I was also called in on the 22nd at 11:45 p.m. due to a burglar alarm going off at the plant. I met with the cops while they were there. Everything checked out okay. And I do have to give kudos to them because they actually stayed and walked with me while I checked the plant myself. And everything was fine then. Randy Wynn and Randy Carr were called in on the 29th at 6 p.m. due to an issue we were having at the plant. This was actually a pretty significant issue in my opinion. We had a 12-inch C-valve that wasn't operating properly, which is basically the main heart of the plant. If that doesn't pump or it doesn't open or close right, we can either flood out the plant right down the road, down the sidewalk, or we could suck our clear walls dry, which means we wouldn't be pumping any water out. So I asked them guys to come back in so we can keep up on the water because we were flooding the plant at that time. And as of right now, that C-valve has been repaired. It is working properly, knock on wood. And the new one has been ordered. I'm not sure the wait time on that. I'm saying 6 weeks. Last time it was 10 weeks, but we're shooting for 6 weeks because they're trying to put a rush on it for us so we can at least get it here and get it in. And then myself was called in on the 30th for the same issues. And I met with the electrician on that one. I had the same issues with the C-valve. Other than that, that's all I have, unless you guys have any questions.
I'd like to say in front of all of you here that that C-valve issue was very serious. It was on a weekend, and I was very impressed at how proactive Derek was in handling it.
And it was John, on the 4th of July.
He's on his game.
As he does.
Yes.
Derek does a very good job. Very good job.
Our goal was to get that at least rebuilt, the kit rebuilt, so somebody didn't have to babysit the plant on 4th of July weekend, which we succeeded. So,
anybody have any questions for Derek? Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Good job. Thanks.
Okay, reports of committees. Area Planning Commission, that will be the one we're going to be ongoing in the future. FEDCO?
Brian's not here.
That's okay. Terry
sent an email.
Yeah. He was going to have a very short report.
I'll tell you here in just a second. Terry, the
shorter than
only
anything.
It's one sentence. My only update for the Redevelopment Commission is to say that I have reached out to Ruth and Jim and are trying to get schedules together for a meeting next week or the week after. We've got two replacements that we need to appoint for the Redevelopment Commission, right? Two?
Yeah.
Yes.
They're the mayor's appointments, and it's Jim Mulligan and Ruth Gunter. Thought we'd get some people in there who have some skin in the game. They're both building owners downtown. Very interested in what happens with the redevelopment effort. Park Board, Mason.
Right, we met July 11th. First off, we had Aaron from Little Lambs Daycare request part of the park be shut down on September 17th from 9 a.m. to 11:30 a.m. for a family bike ride and event. So it's a very small portion of the park, shouldn't affect anyone really, it's the backside. And Joyce Harmon came to talk about the golf tournament that was on the 16th, about the doing a beer cart and liabilities with that, and we got that taken care of, and I haven't heard anything that happened that was bad, so I think everything went smoothly there.
Okay.
And that is all I have up in that meeting.
I might add that the bathrooms are now open too.
The bathrooms are open now?
Yeah.
Okay. All the bathrooms in the park are open. And did JC Park, I know the goals were out. It was blacktopped, wasn't it?
Yeah, it's blacktopped now. And,
so we're just waiting on rims.
Next week we'll be getting the foundation for the basketball that's put up. So we'll
all right. Sounds good.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, the BZA and the Council on Aging. Marty?
Sure. BZA meets tomorrow. A couple of things on the agenda. A couple of pretty simple ones that they've handled pretty routinely in porches and or decks. And then an old business item to meet with Sally by the shore with the to try to get an understanding for what prior appeals were made, and that's the agenda for tomorrow night. Probably not going to be much there. Council on Aging met yesterday for transpo. A new driver / dispatcher was hired. She's going to split her time between the two jobs. They have figured out that there's a new billing system that they can do with the Medicare that they lost about 3 years ago. They lost about $50,000 of revenue because of the way they could bill Medicare. and those issues have been resolved, and they think that they're going to come close to restoring that $50,000 of revenue within the next year.
So they can go back and retroactively?
No, going forward.
I see.
Physicals were given by IU Health for all the drivers. Excuse me a second. And they have gotten those physicals moved where they can do them in Huntington instead of going to Indianapolis, and the cost savings is about $150 per driver, so it's significant. On the Council on Aging side, Randy Sutton has been named to the board to replace Andy Perkins. I don't know if you've gotten that message or not yet, Andy.
We talked about it prior to the meeting. I've been on that board a long time, and it's probably time for someone else.
So apparently you don't need a law degree to hold that position.
No.
Andy is staying on as our legal counsel, which we appreciate. He's been a good member. He expressed his interest in going off of the board, so we are accommodating Andy. I do want to mention that the flagpole, for those that don't know, has decided to close their doors, and it's only significant here in this report because they've made significant donations of food products to the Council on Aging, which has in turn given that to a lot of people in the community. So all of the buns, a lot of the frozen foods, everything. So that's greatly appreciated. August 15, the council is taking two bus loads to the Indiana State Fair. Those buses filled up within hours of being available. And so that's they'll have a good day with that. The roof repair is all completed. I will say that they're very happy with the way the yard, bushes, weeds are being maintained now. Certainly some improvement in the way that's handling, and that's very much appreciated.
It's a credit to Warren.
Yep. Randy Williams, really.
Okay.
Yeah, he's kind of in charge of that.
They're going to be doing a installing a new phone system. That is, RTC is doing that. It's going to be paid for by some leftover funds in that community foundation grant that was given to the council. There is a cookout that is planned for the 31st of August. That's a Wednesday at noon. And they are up to their necks with auditors that are here this week, and that should finish up by the 29th. So transportation units for the month of June, up again another couple hundred dollars this month, or this year from 2015. So they're still averaging up 190 rides more a month or so. It's incredible.
It is. It's phenomenal.
That's my report, pending questions.
Questions for Marty? Okay, Brian, how about the tree board and EMS?
Tree board met on the 7th of July. Gray Dowson and Teresa Hauser were present. One of the issues was a carryover item regarding whether there'd be eligible funding from the Community Foundation for any of the trees, the planters, or anything. And Teresa was going to check with Brian Johnson to see what the status was or if we'd be eligible for anything. The representative from Stormy's Tree Service was there as well. Feedback on his work was that the work was good. In my understanding is that he had turned in his invoices, or at least for the first bid that went out. We spent the bulk of an hour or so reviewing new trees, new ones that were, whether we take them down, leave them, trim them up, or whatever it might be. So that's going to be for the next round of bids.
Okay. Questions for anything on the EMS?
Yes, okay. EMS met. Well, the first of the quarterly meeting, so they do come here and there. Met on the 8th day of July. The report was that the new radios were in for the trucks. The new monitors were in as well, but they were not on the trucks yet, and they're still working on getting those done. And I believe on most, if not all, of the ambulances, they have what are called power cots, which, when they're lifting people up, very helpful to not throw people's backs out.
Or drop them.
Well, it can still get dropped, but the main thing was easier getting them in and out of the vehicle. Still working on memorandums of understandings with the surrounding areas. One was Pulaski County, they're still working on that. But it sounds like everything was going as smoothly as possible. They did report that, I think it was at least the Sheriff's Department officers were trained with the Narcan use and are now in the cars. And since that meeting, and you may have heard that within the past couple weeks, the officers did use the Narcan to bring somebody back or whatever the thing was from the overdose. So it was refreshing to hear that on the radio that they actually had been trained and used to save somebody.
It's one of our county deputies, wasn't it?
Yes.
Chief Schatz.
Yeah.
So it's good to see that was something in use and in action. Talked with the regarding the rehab protocol. I believe the Chief Butler was involved with that discussion as well, and that's ongoing. There's an item regarding some legal action regarding outstanding bills owed to the county for EMS, and I wasn't sure exactly what that was, but they're still working on getting things paid that way. And there was also an issue of where to store old EMS records. Lutheran really doesn't want to hold on to them, but they're looking at a place to move them from one place to the other so they are kept and secured in case they're ever needed. And the next quarterly meeting is going to be in October, so I won't report on them.
Yeah, as far as the records and the income and such coming in, I was at the county council meeting this last week, and they are still receiving income from the EMS program because of delayed billing with Medicaid and Medicare and such. So they'll be probably in that program for a few more months before it's actually completely a Lutheran program. Okay, any questions for Brian? Okay, John, Water Board.
On July 5th, the board did approve the two-year-old accounts, and Martin made the motion, the second from Jim, and third from Keith, the past three. The two-year-old accounts are, once the accounts are standing, they have not been paid for 2 years. They have to approve and get them out of the billing cycle, recalls, and they just basically go away. And of course, we get stuck with that. So that's going to be what a couple of the other ordinances I'm going to talk about that was brought up, and the one is on the water turnoff charge. For years, we kind of had the good buddy policy where, somebody's gone, you come out and shut off the water, come back, shut it on. Well, a lot of these times, it's happened where there's actually times when it happens on a weekly basis, and if not, in some cases, monthly basis. And we already have the ordinance number 52.025. On the books that we can charge for this service because it takes a guy to go out there. So then, of course, if you turn the water on, if it's been off for a month or so, it's a good idea to have someone there when you turn it off in case you do have a problem. So we're going to start enforcing that ordinance. And the other one is for the meter application forms that we're going to be starting to enforce this ordinance also. So water will be charging residents that purchase homes now, not just renters. And it's been on the books, and again, we've been the good old boys for quite a while, but now we do need to generate some funds, and we're going to start enforcing that ordinance is number 52.017, and it is in place, and starting August 1st, that will be enforced. As a matter of fact, both of those ordinances will be enforced on the 1st of August. And then Derek, he's telling you about that 12-inch C-valve. as he covered very well everything on the water board, but the price of that C valve was $5,714. The doors 12 1 and 2 have been installed, and the new locks and latch protectors have also been installed on these doors. Everything else was done and going smoothly with the water board.
Any questions for John? I thank you, sir. Any unfinished old business anyone has to report on? Okay. Under new business, anything new? Just for general information, under new business, our 9th and Main Street project, if you've noticed, the materials have all been delivered to the site, brick, the mortar, sand, everything necessary to start, and we're anticipating with no complications involving the bricklayer, that activity will start first part of next week, the building of the wall. Another thing I wanted to let the council know is yesterday I spent most of the morning up at Pearson at Paragon Medical with the owner, Toby Buck. Finally got to meet, and it was a very, very good meeting. He's very encouraging. He says what we're doing in Rochester right now reminds him of Warsaw about 25 years ago. And it was very complimentary of the solicitation process for business, and just wanted us to know he wanted to be our man in Warsaw when it came to the orthopedic world. Could call him at any time if he needs us to come down and talk to a group of people or talk to anybody interested in coming. He would be willing to do that. Said he would keep us posted as to everything and anything happening up there, not only in his company, but throughout the ortho world. He said, the titanium industry has been very good for Warsaw, but Warsaw was where you folks are 25, 30 years ago. And he said that all changed with the Mayor Ernie Wiggins coming into play, and things started rolling. And he says, today, that titanium industry, and this got my attention, in sales dollars shipped on an annual basis out of Warsaw, means $16 billion. And he says, Mayor Ted, that's a lot of tax dollars generated. So it was a great meeting, very encouraging, and we now have a friend in Warsaw, so we'll keep that contact. He wants to come down, bring a couple of his entourage and come down for dinner at the Evergreen. He'd heard of the Evergreen restaurant, but had not had an opportunity to come down and try it out, so we're putting some dates together for, to come down, and perhaps some of us can join him on that night. So that was a very encouraging trip.
Did you tell him we didn't need all $16 billion, just
yeah. One my reaction was, is that with a B? He said, that's with a B. So, yeah, I knew that it was big business up there, but did you have any idea it was that big? No, I didn't either. I didn't either. Okay, any legal report? Anything?
I did not have anything to report.
Okay. All right. ADA, no ADA concerns. Brings us down to ordinances and resolutions. We're looking at ordinance 05-2016, amending the traffic schedule.
Need a motion to read the amendment?
Please. Do I have a second?
Second.
And those in favor, signify by raising your right hand. 5-0. Okay, would you like to read that there?
Yeah, I understand Brian volunteered me to.
That's what's the message I received.
Yeah, well, thanks.
Are you going to read it by title only or in its entirety for
entirety.
The first reading?
Ordinance number 05-2016, an ordinance to amend the traffic schedule. Whereas the Common Council of the City of Rochester has determined that certain portions of the city's ordinances involving vehicle parking should be amended. Now therefore be it ordained by the Common Council of the City of Rochester, pursuant to its authority under Indiana Code 9-21-1-3A7, that Chapter 75, Schedule 3 of the Code of Ordinances for the City of Rochester is hereby amended as follows. The intersection of Pontiac Street and Rochester High School Drive is designated as a three-way stop.
Okay. Do I have a motion for the second reading of Ordinance 05-2016?
I have a question first.
Okay, sure.
I'm new to the area, but is High School Drive a city street, or is that because it's on the school property there?
I think it's school property.
The partner is High School Drive, is school property.
Okay, because I drove past there yesterday and it's a one-way street.
Well, they're changing.
I know they plan to change it, but do they change it, or do we change it with an ordinance first? It'll be before, right? Because right now it's not a three-way intersection, it's only two-way.
I'll let Chief speak to that.
The drive in to the school, that's their, we're not changing that, they are. That's their property. All we're doing is basically putting a stop sign on Pontiac on either side of that drive. They can control that however they want.
Are they going to have a stop sign going
when you come
to
up
Pontiac?
Pontiac, they're going to put a stop sign there.
Yeah, I don't know how much of it you explained. Skeeter was
well, he just did a little bit, but that's why I didn't know.
Well,
right when you make the curve coming,
I know where it is.
15.
Yeah,
there's going to be one right there. You have to stop before you can get to the turn right to go up towards the school. Then there's going to be a two-way traffic coming back from the school down here. There's going to be one at the old football field, and then there's going to be another one coming as you're going south or north,
right,
up towards 15th Street on that curve. There'll be one right there on the right, stopping the traffic going that way.
There have always been parking and driving congestion issues out there because you're dealing with two schools side by side right there, and everybody is driving, and more students are driving, as I understand. So they're taking a different approach to traffic control than they have in the past. It'll be pretty interesting for a few days till everyone figures it all, it gets figured out. And their school personnel are all highly involved in making sure that happens. Even to the point, and correct me if I'm wrong, Andy, but I believe they were considering staggering when they were going to let high school students out too, because that's about 80 cars right there in itself, and they might do half and half, getting the congestion out of the area.
But again, if the school is going to put up their own sign on that one, do we have the authority, I guess, to make the three-way stop? If they're going to put their sign up or not going to put it up?
No, that's our call at that juncture.
I think where you're getting confused, Brian, where the school's property actually starts. See, I'm showing them a map.
Here's where Pontiac comes in. Mm-hmm. School's property actually starts here. This is where we're putting the three-way. So this is actually controlled by the city.
Not putting it here?
No.
Okay.
No, the school will be putting it here. We are putting it here.
Is this going to be two-way? This is not going to be?
Well, there would have to be a stop because this is currently one-way, so they're going to make this a two-way.
Right.
So this is the school's responsibility. So they're putting a stop sign there, or they're taking that one-way and turning it into a two.
Yeah, they're going to put a stop sign there.
Yeah.
Isn't that already four-way stop?
No, this is not. This is only a stop on Pontiac. Oh,
okay.
15th Street goes straight through with no stop. There's a stop up here at Jefferson, 15th. That's a four-way stop.
So where are we putting the stop signs?
Right here.
That's
Pontiac.
15th. This says.
This is Pontiac and Rochester High School Drive.
This is where the ordinance talks about. Got it.
So is it Pontiac and 15th?
You're talking here.
This is
Pontiac.
Football field.
Back to
school.
Yeah.
This is
how I first. Yes.
Well, okay. No, that's Main Street. Okay, I'm with you. Pontiac comes this way to the three-way. And then it comes around to go here, and this is where we're talking about. This is Pontiac right here.
Everybody stops.
And even this, out by the baseball field, is considered Pontiac. The school is going to put one there. This is going to be two-way traffic. This is already two ways of traffic.
Yeah.
So we're putting one here and here for north and southbound traffic on Pontiac.
You're asking for a two-way stop there. The school's going to make it three-way.
Yeah, basically. Yeah.
It will be a three-way stop at that intersection.
I understand what you're saying. We can't.
Everybody stops.
To dictate that a three-way stop and that's a school property. So maybe it should have said two-way.
No, I just want to be clear. I don't have a problem with that. I just didn't know.
Actually, that's going to be another
right-of-way. What if that's made two-way? Because there is a one-way sign there now.
They're going to take that down. They're in the process of restriping.
Where the school's going, it's going to be an our
right-of-way.
There's going to be arrows on the road itself.
So we are creating a three-way on our property.
Yes.
Yes.
Because it's in the right-of-way.
And asking the school to put up their sign.
No, Lenny just said
that. Yeah, they're already doing that, whether or not we do this or not.
Okay.
So, because Pontiac is all the way through there.
I'm telling you. So you're stopping if you're coming from the north, you're stopping if you're coming from the south, and you're stopping if you're coming from the west.
Yep.
It's a three-way stop right there.
Right.
From the east, you've made a misturn
You're coming from the east, you're in somebody's yard, and you're probably going to jail.
Hey, Brian, if you see a doctor, bang the stop
button. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, I always walk anyway, so that's probably not a problem.
Do I have a motion for the second reading?
So moved.
Second.
Those in favor of the second reading by title only?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm sorry, who made the motion?
Mason.
And then you seconded?
Second.
Ordinance number 05-2016, an ordinance to amend the traffic schedule.
And I'd accept a motion. Entertain a motion.
Third reading.
No. You want to accept?
Did we ever cut the first one after discussion?
Oh, you know what? I don't think we did.
You asked a question. Yeah, you asked a question. That's right. I'm sorry.
I messed it up.
Well, now that's all right.
Way to go, Brian.
I got off track with you.
At least I corrected it.
Are we okay, lawyer?
Yeah, just proceed to second reading. You started that.
Okay, so well, that was the first reading. Motion for the second reading.
Well, we better vote on the first reading.
Well, he's saying that was our vote.
Oh, that
first
was reading. Our vote.
Even though you,
thought you voted on the second reading. You started to vote on the first reading. You started to call for the second.
No, we didn't vote on the second. Well, we didn't vote on the first.
Didn't vote on the first.
We moved to the second reading.
He got into a discussion.
Yeah, he started discussion.
Actually, it was shot as math. At
okay.
Microsoft.
Yeah, it was.
Okay, I'm going to back it up here and we'll go out of order.
Look about it.
I'd like to have a motion to after the first reading. Those in favor signify by raising your right hand. Okay, 5-0.
Got it.
So then we jumped. You got the second reading.
I got the second.
We're all set.
Ready for the third.
Okay.
Motion for the third reading, ordinance 05-2016 by title only.
Second.
I'll second.
Those in favor, 5-0. Okay.
Ordinance number 05-2016, an ordinance to amend the traffic schedule.
Okay.
I would move to approve ordinance number 05-2016.
And a second.
Second.
Mason seconded. Those in favor, and it's 5-0. Okay. Next ordinance is 06-2016. Do I have a motion to read 06-2016 in its entirety?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Second.
Those in favor? 5-0. Marty, would you read 06-2016, please, in its entirety?
Lenny, we're in trouble because the last one was just one paragraph and this is five, so somebody better call dinner in. Ordinance number 06-2016, an ordinance establishing a special Lowit fund per State Board of Accounts directive. Whereas the Common Council of the City of Rochester, pursuant to Indiana Code 6-3.6-9-17, the State Budget Agency will make a one-time special distribution to each county having a positive balance in the county's trust account as of December 31st, 2014. Before June 1, 2016, the county auditor shall distribute to each taxing unit an amount equal to the taxing unit's allocation amount as a one-time special Lowit distribution. Reference House Bill 1001 and Senate Bill 67. Whereas the Common Council of the City of Rochester understands that counties, cities, and towns have restrictions on the use of at least 75% of the special distribution received for infrastructure as found under Indiana Code 6-3.6-9-17H1A, the remaining part of the distribution may be used for any of the purposes of the county, city, or town and deposited into the rainy day fund. Whereas the Common Council of the City of Rochester further understands that for cities and towns, the State Board of Accounts has designated Fund 257, titled Lowit Special Distribution, to receipt and account for the restricted portion of the distribution. The unrestricted portion may be deposited into the general fund, into a properly created home rule fund, or into the rainy day fund, if properly designated as a source. Whereas the Common Council of the City of Rochester, pursuant to Indiana Code 36-1-3, has the power to establish a home rule fund for the purpose of receipting and expending the restricted portion of the special Lowit distribution. Now, therefore, be it ordained by the Common Council of the City of Rochester, pursuant to its authority under Indiana Code 36-1-3, that the fund Lowit special distribution be established to meet the statutory requirement of the IC 6-3.6-9-17, House Bill 1001, and Senate Bill 67 for the restricted funds. Section 1. These funds are restricted to the purpose of infrastructure as found under IC 6-3.6-9-17H1A and cannot be used for any other purpose without statutory authority.
Is that all?
That's it, unless you want me to say Indiana Code 6-3 anymore.
Do I have a motion on Ordinance 06-2016?
Move to approve. Mm.
No. You have to read it two more times.
Oh, for the twice.
Unless you have any discussion.
I move to
read
Ordinance number 06-2016, suspending the rules and reading by title only.
Second.
How do you vote? That's signified by raising your hand. Boy, you could have made it rough.
Ordinance number 06-2016, an ordinance establishing a special Lowit fund per State Board of Accounts directive.
Okay. Accept a motion on 06-2016 for the third reading.
So moved.
Yeah, we've got to vote to.
We did vote on
the second. The second. We voted on the first one. We didn't on the second one yet. Okay, those in Those in favor of ordinance 06-2016, the second reading by title only, signify by...
No, you did read that by title only. You voted on that. It was 5-0.
Did we vote on...
Because that was when we were holding out. John was the holdout.
Well, okay, we had it by
title
only.
So now you got a third reading. So now you got a motion by Marty for the third by title only.
By title only.
Suspend the rules. Yeah. So you need a second, and then you're ready.
Is that your motion? It's third reading by title only.
Yeah, that's what they did, yeah.
Yes, I would move to suspend the rules by...
Yeah, for the third reading, it would suspend it again.
Need to suspend the rules and do it by title only?
Yes.
That's your motion?
Yes, it is.
Mason's second. Those in favor? Okay.
Ordinance number 06-2016, an ordinance establishing a special LOIT fund per State Board of Account Director.
Okay. Now, motion to approve ordinance 06-2016.
So moved.
Second. Signify, right hand, approval, 5-0. Okay. No, we don't have any more.
And look, Marty, there was no discussion on that one.
No discussion.
Good job, bud.
Okay. That completes our agenda. Do I have a motion to adjourn?
Oh, can I say one thing?
Sure.
On 18th Street, I don't know if anybody's went, I made a little stroll down there today and went down there and looked. If anybody hasn't gone and looked on it, council members or anyone else in the city that's looking at it goes down like it, that's really nice.
Thanks.
Now, if we can just get it down 4th Street.
It's really nice on 18th Street.
That's wonderful.
I use that a lot. And
there's been a lot of compliments on that, yes.
It's wonderful.
A week ago, this last Friday, when it was about 3/4 of the way completed, I was going down there about 6 o'clock in the evening from Main Street, and there was a young mother on the sidewalk with two sacks of groceries and two little ones walking in front of her, and I rolled the window down. She didn't know who I was, and I said, "Hey, what do you think of this sidewalk?" And she turned and she gave me the quote of the year: "It's gonna make my life a lot easier." And that I drove away saying this is what it's all about right there.
Very nice.
Thanks, John. Good. Motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second? Okay, we're in adjournment.